Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming. Today we have like great pleasure to have Jeff here from Tigo Energy. Jeff has more than 6 years experience in the Australian market. He's Canadian. Don't be. In the last three and a half years, he's with Tigo that work on smart modules, and that's like sounds like a very interesting topic. So we asked Jeff to come from the coast here, and he was very happy to do that. So please welcome Jeff.
Okay, well, good afternoon and thank you. Today, the topic of our conversation is power electronics from vision to reality. And before I start off, I'd like to do a special thanks to Linda Kosh for introducing me to Zivi and this group. So again, special thanks. Also, a quick disclaimer, my boss and direct report in the U.S. is a gentleman by the name of Zvi. And so if I refer to Zivi as V, my apologies in advance. It is a real privilege to be able to come here today and to speak to a group like this, a group of people who have proactively chosen to study and potentially make renewable energy their future career, and to be part of an ever-changing and uncertain energy future. And so it is my hope that you truly are able to take something away from today's session. excuse me. When I studied, this type of course was not available, and for myself, I ended up in the solar industry either by chance or by accident. But I am truly grateful to be part of this young, innovative, and creative technology. Myself, I grew up in Protestant Canada on the east side, very close to Toronto, beside the French Quarter. And I came from a very strict Protestant family. And through my religion, I was taught to always test all things and prove if they are so, and to esteem others better than myself. And from the country of my nativity, I was taught the importance of higher education and the importance for education for all of our people. And I've taken these values or fundamentals with me, and I've applied them to my work in life. And I've been truly privileged to be able to work with so many innovators and key individuals within the solar industry. Today, we're going to take a look at DC optimizers from introduction through to development and what I call commercial reality or bankability. We'll also take a look at the important role that power electronics have to play in this ever-changing solar PV landscape. And we will also have a look at what's new or what new innovations are coming out in the DC smart module segment. I came from a UPS background, and I started my career in the solar industry some 6.5 years ago with Brisbane-based distributor Choice Electric. The company was a very engineering-focused company, stressing the importance of quality components and quality installations, and they'd been in the distribution business for over 20 years. Now, when I joined the market, there were really only two inverter brands that I was aware of at the time. Both of them were European, one being Fronius, the other being SMA. And at that time, we were selling solar panels for somewhere around $535 per watt. So this was all pre-feed-in tariff days, and with panels today well below a dollar per watt, you can see how significantly this market has changed in that short period of time. Okay, so my first introduction into power electronics came many years ago with a DC optimizing technology called Solar Magic, and I'm not sure if anybody here is familiar with Solar Magic. Anybody heard the name? Okay. It was a DC optimizer without any type of monitoring. It was actually relatively expensive, but it was actually relatively inexpensive when compared to the total system cost of the day. System sizes at this time were still relatively small, so between 6 to 12 panels. And mismatch was not a big issue, or I probably should better quantify that it wasn't a very well-known issue. And shading at this time was not a big problem because panel pricing was still fairly high or fairly significant. But even so, having said all of that, we did actually relatively well with this product. But unfortunately, not long after, National Semiconductor unsold the brand to a company called Power One, who effectively put it on the R&D shelf. But it was my first real introduction to power electronics, and I was truly fascinated and very impressed with the promises that it held in regards to improving installations and improving system power recovery. As you can see here, this is a slide by Photon Labs where they assessed DC optimizing technologies within a string environment around this period of time. And what you can see is that when you have any type of shading, losses to a traditional string system can be quite significant. And so by using optimizing technology, your recovery rate can be very significant. I also think it's very important to also qualify at this time just a statement regarding power electronics in general. It doesn't matter whether it's a microinverter or a DC optimizing technology, none of us can actually add energy to a system. So we can't add energy, we're not tracking the sun. The only thing that we're actually doing is preventing losses of existing energy within a system. Okay, now it was about this particular time that my then CEO, a gentleman named Mark Norman, had identified a number of up-and-coming new DC optimizing technologies, one of these being a product called Solar Edge, and the other one a product called Tigo Energy. The first was a proprietary technology, meaning it's closed loop, so you have to use all proprietary components. The second was an open DC architecture or an inclusive architecture. And so that meant that it worked with all the different inverter brands and types available on the market. Okay, both of these products offered or brought to the market enhanced safety that didn't exist previously. And so we had the ability to switch off the DC at the panel level or to isolate it at the panel level. And we also had the ability to see our panels or our assets down to a very granular point. And we had the ability to have some key indicators or values such as voltage, current, power, and temperature. So this was my first real introduction to power electronics. And I was fascinated and I was truly impressed on what I could see as the potential of these technologies. So just really to cap the market at this time, the conditions that were present at development, we had seen panel pricing come down from $5.35 per watt, so we were down below $2 per watt. This is actually quite significant or important because from a power electronics point of view, it meant the amount of cost that we were adding to a system actually had increased because the cost had come down so much. We also see at this time there were a lot of poorly planned, implemented, and coordinated feed-in tariffs occurring across the country. And what this did, it actually led to severe product shortages within the market. We also had a RET price that was fluctuating quite wildly at this time. And this led to a flood of new products entering the market. We saw a lot of new inverters, and we saw Tier 2 and Tier 3 panels entering the market to fill the shortage void. This also had a fill-on effect or a flow-on effect to the market in the fact that we start seeing at this point in time installers starting to use pricing as a leveraging tool to try to win business. And in my opinion, this further damaged the industry. The other thing, I've just got a quick note here, and this is important for anybody who may go to manufacturing or any industry of that nature. And selling, when we look at price, typically it only has one direction, and unfortunately that's usually a downward direction. And so assessing all the conditions at this time, my manager made a comment to me. He said, "Oh, look, SolarEdge and Tigo, we're never going to be able to sell these products. They just add too much cost to the system." And I think it's really interesting. The Chinese word for danger is quite interesting because it's made of two components, one being danger, the other being opportunity. And so while my manager assessing the market at the time could only see danger with these products, I kept kicking myself because all I could see was opportunity. And so when I looked at the market, the changes that I saw, the system size or the average system size had grown significantly. So we were seeing average system sizes between 10 to 20 kilowatts. And that meant that we had panel numbers between 46 to 92. And this is important because it increases your potential for a mismatch, and it also increases your potential for shading. We had had a lot of system failures due to poor quality components, and this had highlighted a need for better monitoring within the industry and a better way of understanding the health of our assets. And at this time, many of the sellers who had really been using price as a tool to win business, they were actually going out of business because they weren't making a decent profit. And those who remained within the industry were desperately looking for ways to add value to their proposition so that they could increase their margin position. Also note that at this particular time, we actually began to accept forms of shading as being acceptable. So previously, when I first started, installation which would be north-facing, there would be no shade. Today, it's very common or quite significant to always have shading of some sort on a site. And by this time, customers had started to become more sophisticated, and they were actually demanding a better way to see their asset and to understand that their asset was working. And so this brings us to what I believe is truly the most exciting phase within the power electronics market, and I refer to that as the bankability phase. And so it's at this point in time that we see Tigo Energy as a company bring to the market the world's first true OEM smart module. So this is a module that took our electronics and our functionality, so monitoring functionality, optimization functionality, safety functionality, and smart curve technology, and packaged it up right into the junction box of the panel. So a very significant milestone. You also see within the power electronics industry, we got to a point where we were better able to articulate the different values of our technology. So back in the solar magic days, we talked about more energy. So we talked about mismatch, we talked about power recovery. But now we were able to quantify more benefits to the technology. So active management, so the ability to actually see all of our individual assets and assess them. The amount of installations going in the market had grown significantly. And so again, the need for safety had grown significantly. And also with system sizes growing, the demand or need for greater flexibility within the design section had also grown. And so again, our IMP function, which is our MPPT function, and technologies like smart curve became extremely important to the market. Now, to understand bankability, I think it's first of all important to actually understand risk. And so I've gone to Webster's 1812 dictionary, my favorite dictionary, and looked up the definition of risk. And so in a commercial sense, it is the hazard of loss. It also signifies the degree of risk or danger. And if we go to Free Dictionary online and look up bankability, you will find terms acceptable to a bank or bankable funds or guaranteed to bring a profit. So bankability is all about averting risk. And so it's very important to understand Tigo Energy was a startup company. We had originally a limited number of product in the field. How did we get to a bankable phase? And so by this point, we had somewhere over a million units in the field. But the reason we were able to reach bankability all comes to method of operation. So how we address the problems within the industry. And some of the things that make Tigo Energy very unique within our space, all of my competitors that I'm aware of all use mechanical devices. So they're mechanical MPPTs. They have a number of mechanical functions that they must always do. Tigo Energy took a very different approach. And so earlier I mentioned that we had a open architecture that we supported all different inverter brands. and that's part of the methodology. But effectively what we do, we use a small amount of electronics driven by software. And so the benefits to that are, first of all, we are able to have a highly efficient device. So we operate at 99.6% efficiency. It means we produce less than a quarter of a watt of heat at the panel level. From an electronics point of view, we have less than 100 components on our PCB board. That's two times fewer than our closest competitor. And this is also very significant because every component you lay down onto the PCB board is a potential failure point. So minimizing your components minimizes your risk of failure. Another important thing within our methodology is what we call duty cycle. And earlier I made a statement that as a technology, power electronics are only dealing with mismatch. That's what we do. We prevent losses due to mismatch. And so in a string environment or a central environment or an off-grid environment, if there is no mismatch, we actually just sit and monitor. We don't have to do anything. We only intervene when there's mismatch. And this is, again, very significant because if I compare our technology in 10 years' time to a competitor's technology, we typically have around 50% less wear and tear on the electronics because we only operate when we have to versus mechanical componentry that always has to work. So a combination of these things and heat, I should have mentioned earlier, heat is very important because in electronics, heat is the biggest killer of electronics. So by eliminating heat, you eliminate potential failure. So the combination of all of these items combined allowed us to reach a very high MTBF calculation. That's just mean times between failure calculation. And it was this information that we then had to take to third-party engineering firms that actually dealt with the banks. They had to assess the information. And then they provided their reports to both the banking industry as well as our OEM partners, panel partners. And so by this time, as I mentioned, we had over 1 million units in the field. We had a very high reliability rate and very low failure rate. And it is this bankability that leaped us into the next phase of this industry. Also, I mentioned with the release of the smart module, we also brought some new technology to the market or some new features. And one of these is a technology called Smart Curve. And effectively what Smart Curve is, we take a traditional solar panel and we're able to take the traditional VOC value and we're able to actually shift it or move it very close to VMP. Okay, so the VOC moves close to VMP. Some of the benefits to this, by having a lower panel VOC value, we are able to actually run longer strings. And so in a commercial sense, this means that I might be able to run longer strings and fewer strings. So I might have fewer home runs, I may have fewer isolators and other components within our system. But it's also very significant when it comes to the inverter. With a typical inverter, when you're designing a system, has anybody designed a solar system here? Okay, so VOC is quite an important value too when you're designing. Okay, so in a traditional system, we use the VOC value to design the system. And so what this means is that we tend to fill the inverter or to put about 75% usable energy onto that inverter. We leave approximately 25% headroom or space in case we have a VOC event. So why is Smart Curve so innovative? By having the lower VOC value, we're able to change the fill factor of the inverter. And so we can now fill or populate that inverter with about 89% usable DC energy. We haven't bought a bigger inverter, we've not changed our system in any way, but we've been able to get a few more panels on, which means we have more DC energy, which means we can start up earlier, we have more energy through the day, and we can run longer throughout the day. This also is significant because it improves your customer's ROI period or return on investment period. I also mentioned that as the market had begun changing, system sizes began to grow. We started to see a lot larger systems coming in. And one of the significant benefits that came along with power electronics was the ability to see the individual packet on its own, assess its health, but understand where that package or that item was deployed. And so here you can see a system designed for a 400 kilowatt system. There's around 1800 panels here. If I switch over, this is what it would look like from our viewing web portal. But the significance is that if I had a panel and I had a panel fault, not only would I be able to understand that issue without having to test my strings, if I went onto this site and I had never been there before, I should be able to quickly orient myself, find that item, and test and repair that item. So it brought a great degree of efficiencies to the O&M side of the business. Some other things that we started to learn, and there's some very unique patterns that we see down in the southern hemisphere that we don't see in the northern hemisphere. What you're looking at here is a screen capture or a screen dump out of my off my test system at home. And so this is looking at irradiance data. One full sun of energy is deemed to be 1,000 watts per square meter. So here in this example, you can see roughly around maybe 11 o'clock in the day, we're already seeing over 1,100 watts per square meter. And at the peak, it's around 1,250 watts per square meter coming off the irradiance sensor. So some test panels that I have, I don't know if you can read it well, but these are 250-watt smart modules. What we can see is the time of the day in the bottom right-hand corner indicates 10:54. These panels are due east. They're very due east. But we can see these 250-watt panels actually running at almost 270 watts. If we look at the irradiance sensor, we see 1,132 watts per square meter. So we have really high irradiance, and we have panels that are running beyond the rated power range. When we switch over to current view, what you can see here, these panels out of the box have a nameplate rating of 8 amps, so that is their rated amperage. But here you can see they're actually driving very close to 10 amps, and in fact, at points they actually went over 10 amps. And just a quick note, on our Gen 1 products, so as a company we're switching between Gen 1 and Gen 2, our optimizers are designed or pre-programmed. If they see 10.5 amps, they will switch themselves off and reset. And that's just to protect down system balance of balance of system components like isolators and inverters. What we have here, this is a one of our public sites. So if you log in, anybody can go and look at this site. This is a 100 kilowatt system down in Dandenong, Victoria. It's very unique in the fact that it's a rooftop system, but it's on dual access trackers, and it's on a single 100 kilowatt ABB inverter. So if we go into the data, and I should actually also highlight that one of the things that is very unique with Tigo Energy, as far as our data capture, we sample data at the panel level roughly every 2 seconds. So that is our sample rate. If I look at virtually all of our competitors, their sample rate between samples is somewhere between 5 to 10 minutes. And so that is very significant. It's the difference between watching a movie clip and looking at a single picture to assess what's going on. So here we can see at 10:20 in the morning, this system is operating, seems to be operating fine. And I should also clarify that we use color to indicate power production. So the brighter the color, the more power. The darker the color, the less power. And this is back from the 21st of the 2nd, 2014. If I move our data segment ahead by 1 minute, we can see that something has actually changed on our system. And I'll just draw your attention to the power band in the center bottom of the graph, and you can see that it's very thin in the morning, so at the time sample that we're looking at. And that's because this is down in Victoria. It's a very heavy overcast morning, but we're getting to a point where the clouds are finally breaking up and we're getting some direct sunlight coming through. If I zoom in on our panels, we can see that the string that we're looking at has no power production, so it's got 0 watts, but other panels or other strings around it are working. And if I switch over to a voltage view, I can see other panels sitting at around 37 volts, so they're under load producing power, but our string is actually sitting at 44 volts, which is open circuit. If I switch over to current view, again, I can confirm that other strings, in fact, on this system are operating, but this particular string is not operating. And so just to quickly run you through what happened on this site, we had a morning of heavy cloud cover. We had a point where the clouds started to break up. We were getting direct sunlight coming through the atmosphere, but we also were receiving reflected sunlight coming off the clouds. And when you go in the second by second data, we can see that the amperage was fluctuating wildly, but again, many points exceeding 10.5 amps. And the high amperage was enough to cause a weak string fuse to blow. Now, being a single 100 kilowatt inverter without any string-based monitoring, one string's roughly equivalent to 5.8 kilowatts, or about 5% of the potential of the unit. Without monitoring or assessment, it would have been probably many months before that customer ever identified that they had a string out. But here you can see from the clock, this is the 24th, so this is 3 days later. We can see that system is actually up and running and functioning correctly. Also note in the morning, you can still see that cloud cover effect in the morning before the clouds break up and we get full power coming through. Before I came down to do this session, I did actually watch a few previous sessions to try to understand the audience and the content that you were looking for. And I came across this slide from a presentation that John Doerr gave a little while back, and it actually really fascinated me. And so I got the data that he was using, and I actually went through and pulled data from our system just to do some comparisons. And some very interesting things. In Australia, we tend to buck all of the trends as far as technology and as far as what we do. And when I say that, what I mean is that customers who have our equipment installed have actually paid a premium to have it on their system. But when I look down to the inverters that are actually underpinning or connected to these systems, within Australia, around 90% of the fleet are all tier one inverters. So when I say that, I mean ABB, Fronius, SMA inverters. And so when I compare the data, you can see over here, and I'm used to my pointer, you can see over here our inverter failure rate is around 5%. And compared to the other data source, 51%. So it just really intrigued me. I saw some similarities, so communication. So in the power electronic space, we are actually getting data off systems, and so that means we have to have a way of pushing it to the web. So we have communications involved, and so now we have a whole new level of complexity or challenges for installer. And so we see around 12% calls due to communication issues. And as the NBN is rolling out across the country, so do our calls for support because they've disconnected the previous connection. And the other thing that I'll note here is that weather. We show a higher weather-related instances compared to the other data. In the previous slide I showed you of Hilton's manufacturing solar farm, we actually would have attributed that fault to weather and not to a DC-related issue. Okay, so it was weather that actually was the factor for the fault. But this is also, this large section over here is very important, and I think one of the things that we've been able to identify by having clearer data, by being able to see systems from day one of commissioning, is that a great deal of problems that occur later on, so whether they're days later or months or years later, many of them actually come back to the original installation and commissioning. And so when I say that, it can be things like panels unplugged, strings left unplugged, strings in reverse polarity. I could go on and on. There's just so many things that we come across. And so what's really exciting is that through better use of power electronics and the data that's available, we can actually significantly shrink or eliminate that major section of fault calls. Okay, so now a little bit about Tigo Energy. And this isn't designed to be a sales pitch, it's supposed to be an information session. But we as a company come out of Silicon Valley, California. We sell around the globe, so we have offices all around the world, and we have over 18,000 systems installed globally. We even, in fact, have a system down in the Antarctic on a research station. We have well in excess of 1 million units in the field, and I mentioned as a technology we're very different from our competitors, so we have over 53 patents filed, and we have about 18 patents that have been granted so far. Okay. One of the other very unique features about us as a company, I mentioned that we are just an open DC architecture. So we work on an on-grid system, off-grid system, string inverter, central inverter, it doesn't matter. And so when you look at systems sizes that we're installed on, they range anywhere from the small 1 kilowatt system up into the multi-megawatt solar farms. Okay, so what is new or innovative within the power electronics or smart module segment? For Tigo Energy as a company, TS4 is it. And TS4 is our next generation of smart module, so OEM embedded product. And this technology offers some new features. So we have gone to modularity, and I'll clarify modularity for you. Selective deployment and predictive IV. With our technology, I'll just quantify on the predictive IV. In our Gen 1 product, we had some additional components, and we had a device called a management unit or a cloud connect device, and the unit itself actually saw the array in real time and made changes to the array in real time. Predictive IV just means that the actual panel itself is doing that that work. It no longer requires these additional components. So TS4, what is unique about it? Effectively, it is a universal or a USB type docking station. So it's just a standard base plate used by many different manufacturers. And what it allows us to do is to plug in different covers or different technologies. And so currently within our TS4 range, what we have done is we've taken our previous smart module, which you would actually call TS4L, it just had all the features on it, and we've actually broken it down into to different offerings. And so you can actually buy just a diodes only TS4 option, and I'll explain why you may want to do that. You can also buy a standard module, but with 2 second module level data. And we go anywhere up to safety, optimization, and full strings. I also mentioned that, again, these are field replaceable. So now an installer using an approved tool, even in the case of failed diodes, can quickly replace the cover plate and replace the diodes or other componentry if required. So TS4M, I mentioned that this allows us to provide very, very low cost monitoring of traditional solar panels. And applications or reasons why you may use this, and I always use that phrase because when I talk to customers who use our product now, they say, why would you do it? You know, why wouldn't you just do the full optimization? But for many large-scale solar farms, they already have some very good string monitoring. What they lack is panel-level visibility. There are other areas in the country, so I support Sri Lanka, India, Indonesia, I guess everything except for Japan. And so some of those markets, again, are also cost sensitive. So having a low cost option as far as giving greater visibility is important for some of those markets as well. TS4S, so what we are now able to do that we weren't previously doing is bring safety to a traditional solar module. So TS4S means that I can have diodes, I can have the ability to monitor that panel, but I also have the ability to shut that panel down or to respond to safety hazards. So we get a lot of people that ask, you know, if I had a fire, you know, what does your technology do? And effectively, TS4S responds to or understands different issues. And in the event of something like a fire, the fire department would come out, they would disconnect the AC fusing to the building, and that would actually be the trigger to cause the modules to switch off. So we actually deactivate the DC at the panel level. For people in the US, it is rapid shutdown compliant. Places like Australia, I believe that we will see things like NEC 9690 coming here. For people who have this already inbuilt, they already meet these higher safety standards. Optimization, so this is something that is quite new, and we have some examples on how PIV can be beneficial. But effectively, as I said, the significant change in our architecture means that every module will always float at its MPPT point. Okay, it doesn't need anything additional. If I stick it out in a string, it will operate at MPPT. You just have to bear with me because these are somebody else's slides, but it's got some animation in that I wanted to use. And so in this particular slide, Gal is just trying to confirm, compared to our Gen 1 product, you do not need any additional components. So again, you can greatly reduce the cost and roll optimization out into the field. Okay, and TS4L, I won't spend much time on this one at all because I talked about it earlier when we referred to inverter fill factor. But TS4L uses our smart curve technology, which means that we have a much lower VOC value, and we can actually get longer strings or increase the fill factor on inverters. Okay, and this particular example, this is designed to show you that if I had a traditional system, but I identified that I had three panels that were affected by shading, I can actually just selectively deploy three optimizers solely on those three panels. Selective deployment. Okay, so this again reiterates that within a string environment, it is possible to deploy any of these technologies all within the same string. And that was not previously possible with our technology. And if I look at our competitors' technology, the same is true. They must optimize all panels within the system. So some design guidelines for the new technology. And this is the animation I wanted to add in. So is rapid shutdown required? This just means that does the module have our safety capabilities inherent within them, and the answer is yes. So in this example, we have six modules. There's no optimization. You can see that there's no shading or mismatch, and the system is performing perfectly fine. If we were to find out that we had shading within the system, it would significantly impact the system, but we can actually go using TS4 or this USB type of baseplate, we can actually go back and change that module and upgrade its functionality. Okay, this I believe is TS4M, so again a very similar comparison. These are non-optimized modules, six modules with monitoring only. Same thing if I deployed them but later found out that I had something impacting my system such as shading that's causing losses to occur. Again, I can go out and I can actually change the panel. So again, it's all about driving down the cost, but in improving the capabilities as far as design. Okay, this is a diodes only example, and one of the, again, this is, I should also reiterate, this product is actually just rolling out, and in fact, I think the first TS4 modules come into Australia sometime this week or next week, so it is actually brand new for the market. This is showing an example with just diodes only, so if I bought modules that use the TS4 base plate, but they were diodes only, but I was doing a very large installation, maybe a commercial rooftop installation, the same scenario. As I'm actually laying down my panels, if I identify problems or shading or issues during the installation, again, on the fly, I can actually change the functionality of that module and maximize the output. The last example I have here is in relation to TS4L. And has anybody, was anybody ever familiar with what we call smart curve or this lower VOC value? No one's heard of it before? Geez, I'm doing a really poor job. Okay, so with TS4, this again is also very beneficial. In this example, under a traditional design, so let's say it's a residential system and we have a 600 volt cap on our voltage, by using TS4L, with a lower VOC value, again, I can have the ability to get more panels onto the system. If I have shading, these are fully optimized panels, so it's only it's going to optimize the entire system. But this example is just showing you with fewer strings, this would be my power output. Because I actually have shading, but I have longer strings, I have a much higher DC output of the system. So again, having a higher fill factor is very beneficial because you're always maximizing the output of the system. Okay, and sorry, this is the last example. This particular example is showing you one of our previous examples where we changed two modules with optimizers, but the assumption here is that this tree over time has actually grown up and become mature or more mature, and it's now shading panels that are not optimized. And so again, in this example, we can actually still go back years later and change and upgrade that system to increase the output of the system. So within our technology, the rules of thumb, because we actually do manipulate voltage and current, if you are selectively deploying within a string on an MPPT, you can deploy it anywhere. One panel, all panels, doesn't matter. If your strings are parallel strings, you must optimize all the panels in the string, and that's again because we are manipulating the voltage at the panel level. Same thing, so in the top example here, diodes and monitoring, there's no difference, they're just regular dumb panels. The only difference is one has monitoring capabilities. You can put them anywhere. Down below, we have optimization, and I covered that previously. All panels on the MPPT of paralleled strings, if you're going to optimize, must have an optimizer on them. Okay, so within our environment, we have three components that we use. We obviously have our smart module, and I mentioned it will work as always at MPPT. But if we want to monitor the system or if we want to provide rapid shutdown capabilities, we would actually use these two other components. The one in the center is a Zigbee transmitting device. Zigbee is a wireless mesh technology, and it just means that if we can't directly talk to a unit, it can actually bounce its packet off other panels to get it to the unit. And what we call a cloud connect is just our data collection device. So it's gathering the data, it's synchronizing the data, and it's pushing the data up to the cloud servers. Okay, I did also watch a talk that I think Nigel Morris did not long ago as well. Was he fairly recent?
A few months ago.
Nigel had talked about all the different types of monitoring, but no single point of gathering all the information together. Nigel needs to spend some more time with me. So with this device, we have the ability to connect to many other devices, so we can connect to inverters and pull their data streams or their data through, weather stations, AC meters, virtually any type of device that speaks Modbus, we can actually pull that data through, synchronize it, and display it with the DC production data. I talked about rapid shutdown, but just note that it can actually be interlocked into things like a BMS system. So if we want to be able to shut down our array, let's say on the university, based on a fire alarm, you can easily do that, or you can have a mushroom panic switch to switch the DC off. The real value to all this data that we're actually collecting at the panel level is it's only good if you can actually get it somewhere where somebody can use it and assess it. And so we are a cloud-based technology. We have both Wi-Fi and Ethernet on our device, and obviously we want this data to go out to a point where it can be used by either the installer or the homeowner. And believe it or not, I've actually had calls and emails from people overseas about their system because they've been able to identify changes or that their system was not working. So we're compatible with things like smartphones and tablets. This is very valuable for people who are actually on-site servicing equipment. You can see in a large-scale system where we may have many panels, the ability to actually see and read data from a smart device becomes important. So you can do that through this device. I talked about our cloud servers. Okay, and again, being a cloud-based system, as long as you have a smart device that has internet, you can log in, see, and access your system. That system actually there is actually within Australia, and that's actually Lakes Business Park. That's actually another public site, just meaning anybody can go and look at the data from that site. Okay, and module level monitoring. Okay, so selective deployment. For those going into the solar industry or involved in the solar industry, for me, this is the exciting part. This is what I've been waiting to get to. We did a test on selective deployment, and here you can see we have an SMA inverter. We wanted to make sure that everybody was happy with our inverter choice. We have a number of sun power panels, and in fact, what we've done here is we've put some fly screen meshing on the bottom of one of the panels. Here you can see we have one panel with TS4O or optimization, and this is just us being able to see the panel. You can also note on the far left hand side that we're also reading the data straight off the inverter, so we're pulling both parameters through. And this particular colorful slide is showing you us running the system with the optimizer switched on and with the optimizer switched off. And so the data in green is with optimization on that panel with shading on it. What we see in red is the inverter data with the optimizer switched off. Here we have the raw data coming off the SMA inverter. And again, the same thing, it confirms that with optimizer switched on, we are maximizing the output of the system. With the optimizer switched off, we're actually incurring losses within that system, the remainder of the system. And so the conclusion was that one optimizer, so just one smart module correctly placed within the system, was able to recover 18% more energy from that system. And for me, that's the exciting part. What that means for the market is that we now are empowering installers again to design better. The reality when you're working in the industry, you always have to be mindful of budgets and costs. So your customer will have a certain budget that they can work within. And for the installer, they have to try to provide them the best quality solution with the best outcomes based on what they have to work with. And so TS4 really ticks all the boxes for me in the fact that we are empowering installers to go back to good design. Okay, and again, just apical wand and string. So the three things that are very new in our industry is this modularity. So again, when I look across the power electronic space, you know, an AC microinverter is an AC microinverter. It's got to act as an inverter. It's got to act as an MPPT, and it does some monitoring, but you can't change that. When I look at our other DC competitors, they're optimizers, monitors, MPPT, and they currently can't change it. So this is the first time that we have had the ability to provide better functionality and features to a wider selection of the market. And for many people who don't yet understand optimization, it's my hope that starting off in monitoring will move them up to full optimization. Another thing before I switch the slide as well, a comment that I'll make, I've been in the power electronic space now for about 6 years, and I'm a hardcore believer. I'm probably the most converted person you'll find, and that's because I've seen so many instances where we've significantly altered the outcome for our clients. So I believe in full optimization. When you look at something like a panel manufacturer's warranty, you'll see that they actually give you a linear derating warranty. And this is in fact very important or significant. This should be a trigger to tell you that over time that panel is electrically changing. And so we know from our data, and I don't know why it's year four, but by year four we start to see significant drifting occurring within the electrical characteristics. So the panels all change differently and they drift further and further apart. And what that means is you actually get more mismatch going into a system as it ages. I believe in full optimization because it doesn't matter what point in its history it is, you're always recovering the maximum power. And I've had many people who have said my system's 4 years old and it's just not doing what it used to do. I just do not know why. So we talked about the five different cover plates. We've quickly touched upon selective deployment, which I think is the most exciting part. Also note that we will be releasing that very shortly as a retrofit product. And that means that for installations that are in the field that have issues or challenges, you can actually go back to older systems. And again, at very low cost, significantly improve the outcomes. And all I got to do is drive from my house to the corner shop and I can pick off about four or five that would benefit from it. And predictive IV. So this just means that you do not have to have monitoring or other components, and it's a cost-saving exercise. So our Cloud Connect and Gateway unit add probably around $350 to the cost of a system. For somebody who doesn't want to monitor the system, they can save the money and use it elsewhere. So basically, it allows us to provide a solution that can be unique to every installation application. We have many OEM partners, so this is just a universal plate, and these modules will fit across any OEM manufacturer's panel. So again, it's usable across multiple different OEMs. And so different covers, different prices, so again, it's all about getting the best design for a customer. And that should take us to the end of TS4, and I'll open up to any questions that anyone wants to ask us or ask me. Gentleman with the hand first.
Thank you. Very interesting. Thank you. You mentioned that you see errors in installation, some people leaving strings disconnected. And
yeah.
You're now making it much more complex, I guess, with five different cover plates and things. Aren't you likely to see more errors in installations with that extra complexity?
Yeah, no, I would say no. So when I look at installation errors, there's many errors that you see. So within Australia, I'm the only Tigo asset on the ground in this area. So I get a lot of calls and I work with a lot of our partners. To give you an example, I had a customer down in New Zealand maybe 2 weeks back. They were powering up a system that had three brand new Fronius inverters on it, and the first unit powered up and the other two units would not power up. So they did just refuse to power up. When I logged in, so I can see what our MPPT function is doing, and what I could see is that all the modules were in safety mode. So as soon as they turned off the DC or switched off the inverters and rotated the isolators off, the optimizers became happy. So they came out of safety mode. And so on those two particular systems, they actually had paralleled strings that were actually connected in reverse polarity. So again, from our side, we went into safety mode. That was the trigger for the customer to, or the installer to identify and to have to correct the problem. When you look at our system, I recently just did a 100 kilowatt system over in Penrith, and while they were still, when they had the panels deployed, and I should actually clarify, as soon as there's sunlight, we actually draw a small amount of power from the panel to drive our communications on the module. So as soon as there's sunlight, you can discover the system. We see voltage, we see current, if there is current movement, and all these parameters. And so normally we try to do that as quickly as possible on larger systems, because if we have bad diodes or panel issues, you want to identify them while the installers are still there working on site and make corrections while you have scaffolding up, etc. So to answer your question about all the different cover lids, I think, will it generate more work for us? Yes, only in the fact that we will identify more problems that were previously invisible. So somebody who was not doing any type of monitoring previously, goes to monitoring, will now be able to see more of what's happening. So I think it will increase our workload, but it won't change the problems. I think they're already there. The big drive is to actually reduce them. So give people visibility, educate them on how to better use the technology, and what we want to do is actually shrink that whole section down dramatically. Sorry, yeah.
Would you be able to comment more on the VOC shifting function of the technology? To me, that's kind of interesting. I've never heard of something that can actually shift what I believe to be kind of inherent characteristics of the module.
Yeah, okay. So our second disclaimer is that I am a salesman. I'm not one of our engineers, but I will do my best to answer your question. So within SmartCurve, there are a number of components. So the first thing to understand is that every TS4L or product that has SmartCurve has a fixed mechanical brake. So this is a hard brake that guarantees that VOC will not exceed what it's rated for. And that is set by every panel manufacturer. So within their panel fabs, they set that parameter. From the technology point of view, I mentioned that we are able to manipulate voltage and current. And so when we have high voltage, we will actually make some adjustments to current. And so it is through the combination of those that we are able to fix the VOC and guarantee the VOC. The other thing to note is that VOC doesn't happen all day long. It may be early morning where you see that type of event, or it may be sort of once or twice in a year. And so the payoffs by having the fixed VOC and by shifting the voltage and current around means that throughout the entire year we get a lot more energy out of that system. I'll also note that on our website we have probably the engineering or the mathematics behind how that works. If you want, you can go, you can download it. It's under white papers, but that will give you the full methodology on how it works and what we're doing. It's the gentleman beside the lady.
You didn't really talk much about price in your presentation. I'm just wondering, so say you work with at OEM level, you know, like in terms of costs, like
yes.
how much do these sort of modules cost?
Okay. Yeah, so another great question. And so I'll maybe answer it in two parts if I can. So I mentioned before we actually hit bankability, we used to make what we call a retrofit device that had a K cables for the DC supply, but we also had a separate set of cables that we could plug a panel into it. And in those days, we probably would add somewhere around, let's say about $60 to a panel to add an optimizer to it. So every panel you put down, you were adding an additional $60. When we released the smart modules, we started off with one OEM and we've broadened it out. And we actually have, I think, five of the top 10 now that all do our smart module. And that is actually increasing as we go along. Pricing becomes more difficult. With our retrofit product, I actually was able to manage the market and the pricing. As soon as it goes into an OEM product, I have no control whatsoever. And so I've seen one vendor 20 cents per watt cheaper than another vendor with a smart module. So they effectively were providing them a smart module at the cost of a regular module or even below a regular module. But I think to be fair to answer your question, I do believe that currently we probably add somewhere between 8 to 12 cents per watt, depending on the size of the system today. That will actually further decrease for many different reasons. From our perspective, I guess what's significant right now as a company, we support four main PCB boards, so four different optimizing boards. TS4 enables us to go down to one PCB, so there's a massive cost reduction, inventory reduction, and so we expect to see prices driven down quite substantially. And again, it's still very early days because this is a brand new product just hitting the market, but it has been very successful so far. Somebody else with a hand? Yes, gentleman there.
On the web display from the comms where you show the array, have you got any plans to actually show on there what optimizer module is fitted to each panel? I'm just thinking in terms of maintenance.
Another great question. So one of the things that's very significant with TS4, I mentioned with our Gen 1 product, and we talked about Smart Curve, and I mentioned that that's programmed at the factory. With TS4, what is very interesting is that on this unit we have a small EEPROM. It carries programming. It actually has the manufacturing date, flash test, manufacturer's serial numbers, etc., all contained on this EEPROM within the panel. And yes, that is readable on TS4 product. So yes, you can actually get all that data straight off the panel, even years down the track. Okay, and the EEPROM that I was mentioning, the reason I mentioned the EEPROM on the base plate is if I took a TS4L, and I mentioned I can use these in any manufacturer's module, the EEPROM itself is what drives the smart curve functionality or programs the smart curve functionality. So it doesn't matter where the plates come from, it's fully compatible across any manufacturer's panel. Yes?
Are your panels, smart panels, approved by the Clean Energy Council at the moment?
Yes, that's correct.
Assuming we use smart panels in all the system, do we still need to use isolators, DC isolators, and fusing?
Yeah. So fantastic question, and I will try to break it up into a couple of components. So with the technology, we mentioned that we bring a depth of safety, you know, enhanced safety to a system, and I can't stress how many times I've seen that beneficial just in this Australian market, where outcomes could have been very, very different. As far as isolators and fuses go, the CEC always try to keep consistency. And so if I'm a firefighter, I have to be able to understand or basically understand a system and know how to turn it off and make it safe. I don't know whether it's microinverters. I don't know whether it's got our technology. I don't know whether it's got SolarEdge's technology. So there has to be some commonality that provides a working reference across all systems. And so I think from the CEC perspective, you'll still see the requirement for isolators, et cetera. From a fusing point of view, I think the code says that if I have three plus strings, that I need to have fusing. I believe that this is still a very valid scenario. I did attend a site once where we saw a junction box vaporized, I mean literally vaporized. And on this particular site, they had multiple inverters, but the array, you know, was sort of seamless. So even though it was different subarrays, you know, it looked like one big array. And at a conversion point between the two arrays, the installers actually made an error and actually connected the two systems to each other. So all of a sudden your string lengths were well beyond any expectation, but you had two arrays connected into one array. And it obviously destroyed the one panel. It was well beyond any amperage rating we could deal with. The point I'm getting to is, had there been fusing, even with the error, it probably would have protected or minimized the impact of the error. So I do think it's still very valid and a good practice. Yes?
I was wondering, like you just mentioned that your DC power optimizers, they work with a wide range of inverters.
Yes.
Do you have to disable the MPPT function in the inverters, or you just remove it?
Okay. So again, another very good question. I mentioned when I started in the industry, I worked for a distributor. We distributed a number of different optimizing technologies, and I sold a lot of my competitors' product into the field. And for me, originally when I started off, Solar Edge was a very easy product because it was mechanical and I sort of knew what it was doing. Tigo sort of mystified me because it was sort of software and I had to actually learn what it was doing. But when I came to appreciate their methodology, or when I chose to join Tigo, I had a number of different offers of companies to go to, and these guys actually paid me the least. But I went to it because I actually believed in the technology. I believed in the reliability of the technology, and again, we're talking about something that's going to be in the field for 25 years. But when I looked at how they approached the problem and how they approached the MPPT issue, the biggest thing that Ron Hadar, who was our founder, strove to achieve was this compatibility with multiple different inverters. And this dates back to the slide I showed you about risk. By having a greater choice of inverters, I have a greater ability to manage that asset over time. You know, if the company I was using went out of business, I can use another inverter. And so effectively what we do MPPT at the panel, but we reflect back an IV curve to the inverter to track against, okay? And so all it means is it doesn't matter what inverter you're using, how good or bad its MPPT function is, the way we approach the problem means that you're always compatible with all of these. So it's a very important part, and we do we always want that MPPT function. And I hope that answered your question.
The only thing I was wondering, because basically the inverter, right, at the time when everything is fine, basically the constant power, constant voltage regulation on the DC side should be provided that each of the panels in the strings are fitted with your DC
yes.
power optimizer, no question about it. So it makes sense that, for instance, if some of the modules will come off for whatever reason, then you lose some of the voltage of the string.
Correct.
Provided you have a bypass switch there. So then the voltage of the inverter has to be adapted, basically, because the inverter is what it's trying to do always, basically to adapt its
yes.
DC voltage to the...
Yeah, okay,
but
so...
But you don't really have like a... Because power optimizers, they do the power tracking, right?
Yeah.
The output of the optimizers is put in series, so you arrive at DC bus, which that one should be more or less constant. It fluctuates only when there are shadings in the system, and then there is no communication between these devices, the power optimizers and the inverter, right?
Correct. So we can work completely autonomous from the inverter, and you're correct. So to try to to answer that question effectively, so a couple things. effectively what we are doing with this device, we actually do very high speed switching. And let's say I had a string of 10 panels. I have one panel that's heavily shaded. Within a string environment, voltage is just additive. So we add the voltage up. But voltage times amperage is where we get power. And so a reduction in amperage is a reduction in power output. And so effectively what our device is doing, we do high speed switching. We allow the string to operate at the maximum amperage. And for panels that are slightly impacted, effectively what we're doing, let's say the panel that's at 2 amps, but the rest of the string's at 8 amps, we allow 2 amps to flow through that panel, we yield from that panel what we can yield, and we bypass around that panel 6 amps, and it will actually appear that there's 8 amps coming out of the panel. To the inverter, it sees an IV curve. It doesn't see all kinds of IV curves. We have a great engineering white paper on that as well that really goes through all the science of impedance matching. I know it comes from a radio antenna background. That's where the technology comes from. And that's actually how we do what we're doing. What is also important when we look at different competitors, everybody, whether it's a microinverter, whether it's other DC optimizing technologies, we all have the same problem. It's just we all take different approaches to solve the problem. The market will eventually tell us which is the best methodology, well, hopefully, or who's more successful. But the key hallmarks of our technology are we go to great lengths to keep this open architecture, so choice. And in the 6 years I've been in this industry, it has changed. I've seen so many things. Companies that don't exist anymore, inverters that have come in with promises and then gone. And when I joined the company, that's one of the things I liked. I could see that managing an asset like this over a long period of time, the methodology had the least amount of risk associated with it. I had the greatest choice, the least flexibility. Many of our competitors do a different approach. There's another optimizing technology, and they do a fixed string approach to the problem, and they do a DC to DC conversion to fix the string length. And that's very interesting, and it's got some benefits. The downside is you burn about 3.2% energy in the conversion. So good design, choice of inverter. This typically tends to be more efficient on power output. And again, in my opinion, over time, it is going to be the most bankable or flexible solution and easiest to manage over time. Okay, so non-proprietary. Any other questions? Yeah, you can ask all you want.
All your modules, they talk to a Zigbee communication module.
Correct.
I was just wondering if the communication phase, let's say one module is not able to communicate the central module anymore, what does the system do? Will that module stop working?
Okay, so a fantastic question. And one of the challenges with talking about this equipment is I can go for an hour in almost any direction, or hours. But that is a fantastic question. Again, when I talked about the reasons I joined the company, that in fact was also a very significant question that I asked. And the answer to that question is also what led me to work for this company. So with our technology, if a cloud unit or a data gateway was to stop working, would the system stop working? No, it would continue to work. What I will quantify is what is the difference in the event that those devices stop working with our current Gen 1 product, which includes encapsulates the current Trina Smarts in the market versus our TS4 product, which is the new Trina Smart Pro and Trina Smart Lite. With our Gen 1 product, we have a management unit. It's a small Linux computer. It literally is seeing the array in real time. And it's working at very high speed and making changes within the system to maximize the output. If the gateway or one of the critical components was to fail, the system would continue to work, albeit it would lose its optimization under Gen 1. under Gen TS4, it would make no difference. It would just fully optimize. And that's because there are, from a safety point of view, there are two distinct triggers that will trigger it into shutdown. The modules know to look for two events. The inverter is not pulling current, so all of a sudden current, request for current or pulling of current stops, and it can't talk to our management unit. If those two events happen within 30 seconds of each other, the unit goes into rapid shutdown and switches off. Okay, so hopefully that answered. Yeah. Any additional questions?
Maybe let's keep them.
Oh, yes. Yes, we'll go to the corridor. Thanks, guys.